There's the man. Yeah, thanks guys, thanks. I got this. Right now I'm on my way to Denver, Colorado, but the truth is I'm just on my way on the trip right now. And the first stop is in Denver. I'm gonna have a show. Got a lot of people showing up, pretty stoked about it. And I'm doing a talk where I'm gonna talk about the astrology of what's coming up in 2015. Help people really understand this really crazy transit we're having, the same one that happened during the Great Depression. So I really want people to get to really know what this whole like energy is all about. So Denver's the first city, and after Denver we'll be going to Chicago, New York, we're gonna do Jacksonville, and we're also gonna do Austin, Texas as the cities that we stop in.
How did this whole thing get started?
This whole tour got started after I got booked to shoot a couple TV shows with John Edward the Psychic in New York. I was just feeling like if I'm going to New York and I'm going to be there for a week filming, I might as well find a way to do a show in New York. So originally it was just going to be a show, me coming to New York, doing the TV show, but I got a feeling inside to network and to connect with all the fans in all these cities and do an American tour. I've never been able to do one, and finally this gives me the ability to finally do one.
Have you had much fan feedback since you announced it?
The feedback regarding what all my fans want me to do seems amazing. I have a lot of tickets sold. People really want to hang out, and I want to hang out with the fans. That's like the main reason why I'm doing this is I want to hang out with everybody. I want to make sure that I get to meet people who are watching, that are supporting the horoscope, and hang out with them and show them, you know, that I'm a cool dude that likes to hang out with people, that even though I go on TV and I do all these horoscopes and I'm always in a studio and I live in Hollywood, that it's all about connection. It's all about hanging out. It's all about, you know, showing people what it's all about. So being here in Washington, D.C. has been amazing. I'm here at the Capitol building right now, underneath the dome. And the one thing that I notice about this city is all the lines are perfect. All the geometry is perfect. The synchronicity, the spacing between things is really amazing. If you ever do like channeled drawings, you really start to notice how you put things together instead of separate. And it's not that things are abstract either. You really start to notice if you're really starting to channel very, you know, perfect spirit, it's usually amazing synchronicity. And you notice in the city and you notice in the buildings, the synchronicity between things, the perfect lines, the aspects where things really start to come together. And I think that's important. You don't see it in our world today. You see things kind of off. You even see in a city, they just put up a new building, cheap, might look good, but you'll notice the quality is not there anymore. It's why things aren't really working out, in my opinion. I mean, this place will be here forever, just like any ancient building. It'll be here a long time, just because of the fact that there was an aspect of paying attention to the details and pre-planning based off like a higher dimensional understanding. And so, being here, you just can see that, and you can feel that wherever you're around, and it feels more comfortable when things are that way. Welcome to your Inspirational Astrology Horoscope for the weekend of October 3rd, 4th, and 5th, 2014. I'm astrologer David Palmer, the Leo King, here to illuminate the collective consciousness.
Oh, nobody's in here. This is where you can do some bad things back here.
It's got to be like right here. They would be idiots to not put it right next to all the people. Oh wait, I see it. I see it, yeah. Give me some. Give me some.
That is
It's right down there. Yeah, I am so thirsty. What has this girl got? What has she got over there? Surprised how hungry I am, too. We had a brunch, kind of a noon lunch up in the hotel room. Ah, yes. Sanctuary has been found. Excellente.
275.
Do you take card?
No.
No? Hold on, I think. What do you guys want?
Without tripping myself out about, I'm a human being on a planet, like, weird. You know? Like, taking in the whole galaxy, taking in where we're spinning. We're believed to just be like, no, I'm just in my, I'm on Earth doing this. But when you do awaken to all this, you realize how, you know, macro we are instead of micro, you know? And that can be overwhelming. Like, it can be shock and awe, you know? And I still feel like I'm going through the shock. And it brings anxiety. So I deal with a lot of anxiety. When the anxiety is this all, it overwhelms. It just overwhelms. It's like, am I going to have a grip again? You know? Like, because I feel like sometimes I lose a grip. Like, I'm like, okay, I just got to ride this weird ride. And I think that's the way the universe works, is that ride and learning to let go of the control a little bit, which is hard for me, you know? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it's hard for everybody.
Yeah, I don't think we've been trained to always have control of it all. And so that's so hard. And the astrology helps. Like today, it was really funny. And David can vouch for this. We woke up in the hotel this morning. We were ready to go. And I don't know if you guys know One Feather, but he lives out here. So I'm going to go hang out with him this weekend at one point. And we're going to film a little video. So I'm talking to One Feather, open up the hotel, and I'm looking out there. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm in Illinois right now. And it just all compounds. And it just gives me anxiety. It just is like, whoa, I'm here. There's moments where you feel like you're out of the body experience and you're just watching yourself, like, be here. So one of the things that I've always thought, and this is kind of just open talk, I feel like we're playing, like this has all happened, and maybe it's like we're all watching this, but through the physical experience of it all. So there's moments where I feel like I'm actually backing off and watching the tape play a little bit, and it freaks me out. And that's happening more and more and more and more and more. I know, especially being a psychic and a channeler, I know what's coming. I know it's going to happen. I know that's already going to happen. The astrology says, my life says, I'm so in sync now with that universal sense that you, when you become that full clairvoyant, it just freaks you out. Because you're not trained for it to be so awe-inspiring or so magical. So it's not a negative thing. It's a positive. But it's hard to handle, like, you know? Does that make sense? I know that's kind of confusing.
Like lucid dreaming?
It's like lucid dreaming alive.
Yeah.
Or, like, because I feel like we are dreaming. Because the truth is when we go back to bed, I think we go home. Like, you know, like, and this is it. Deb would know because she was here. I did this whole thing about dreams at the end of the presentation that was like, it blew my mind because I channeled that from spirit. But dreams, if you look in astrology, so we're going to get a little deep in astrology here, and thank you for opening the question because it kind of brought us somewhere beautiful, is the 12th house in astrology, or Pisces, is the invisible realm. It is just invisible. It's called the endings. It's also where we store a lot of karma, past life energy. So it's interesting to see that we end our day with dreaming.
Ralph's parking lot because she had called.
Yeah.
Do you remember
so
that?
She was one of my best friends and she's like, you have to talk to this guy. Like, you need to meet him. You have to talk to him. So she puts us on the phone. And I was in LA, wasn't I?
You were down there.
You were in LA, but you were down.
I'm like, well, what's your Facebook? I need to add you on Facebook so I can put a face to you and whatever.
Yeah, that helps.
That's so David befriended each other on Facebook.
And then we started our own thing. I'm like, hey, hit her up. We talked, called her on her birthday in 2012, right after I did your reading.
Yes.
And I'm like, let's hang out. We got to hang out.
That's cool. Yeah, so we've kept in touch and, you know.
For years.
Yeah.
It's years now. Yeah. That's what's crazy.
Which is really nice.
And I've known you now for years.
It's been a couple years now. Three,
2 years,
over two for sure.
It's crazy.
Yes. And like I said, when I
you know, you go.
And so I introduced Kristen to David's horoscope, you know, because I knew she was starting to have an interest in astrology. I'm like, you have to, you know, be connected to this individual and start following him. And so that's, you were asking how it all came to be.
Funny, yes.
So my friend Kimberly, who you'll probably meet tomorrow, was the impetus of, you know, the Detroit fan base.
Because she found me on Yelp. That was before I was popular in my horoscopes.
Snowballed.
Which made this feel more family than anywhere, because I don't just go off and.
I know, that's what's crazy. You have a family in Detroit. I mean,
I do.
Like, this base, which is why I was like, he's coming.
I'm very emotionally driven, so for me, it's like I don't just go like comfortable, like, you know, basing half part of my trip to go to a whole area to just go see a certain amount of people. I just don't do that on the trip.
Right. There's so many people that
this
really do
really
love
cool.
you in Detroit, though.
Well,
they are.
Yeah.
We're like,
and I've never been here. I've always wanted to come to Detroit, so now I've got the vibe.
Tomorrow we'll really get a little bit of an insight into
you have to experience.
I haven't been to the D.
You're leaving on Wednesday?
No, I'm going tomorrow in the afternoon. I'm going.
I'm going to show him.
Yeah, Miss Marcia, all this stuff.
Yeah, I'm going to show him. Okay. I'm gonna, as a Sagittarius, I like seeing new things and exploring and traveling. And so I happened to just do a last minute search on hotels, and there was like a really beautiful,
it's gonna be fun tomorrow.
Hotel in downtown San Diego, and it was a great deal, so I booked it, and he's like, that's great, I'll drive down, I'll meet you. And he and I met for the first time in person. We were hanging out, having a great time, and we're in one of the lobbies, and it is packed full of people, and I mean, to the degree where you're like, there has to be something going on here. There has to be some sort of conference.
At the hotel.
At the hotel. I mean, it was packed full of people. So then we started inquiring. We're like, what's going on? They're like, oh, John Edward is here to do a reading.
I knew that was
coming.
I knew that was coming.
And I'm like, what?
And her and I are saying, how do we manifest?
We're like, we got to manifest.
To manifest meeting him. Literally, one exact year later, he finds my horoscopes and hits me up.
He gets a hold of him and he calls me up. He's like, you're never going to believe who got, because we were like, we both were manifesting. We were like, I was envisioning meeting John Edward, who, you know, I just was so in love with. And I'm like, I got to meet him. And I'm like, between the two of our manifestation capabilities, like, it's got to happen because we're both really putting energy out. And it didn't. And I remember thinking, that's so bizarre because Dave and I are so in tune and usually, as it were, manifestation works better in numbers. So when you are actually focusing on something in sync with somebody else, it's actually more powerful. So I was really confused by the fact that it wasn't happening. And then 1 year to the date, he was contacted, and ironically enough, David's mother had gone to the reading as well, because she follows John Edward. And so it was just so bizarre. But I mean, synchronicity never ceases to amaze me. As much as I understand and believe it, things of that magnitude never cease to amaze me. And now not only did he seek him out, but he's invited him multiple times, and it's just, you know, it's just this tremendous story to me. And you know, I'm still, you know, I still look forward to the day of being able to interface with John Edward myself, but the fact that that's just transpired is so incredible.
Yeah, it's crazy. And that's what started this whole tour, is John Edward called me and said, hey, I gotta get you out to New York, we're gonna film a couple episodes. I'm like, great. And I'm like, all right. So I was gonna fly. I'm like, yeah, they got the dates. Then something happened with their dates. It got out. And then they were like, oh yeah, well, we might not be able to have you fully anymore. I'm like, oh, okay. So I waited. And then at the last second, they're like, sure, we're gonna bring you. I'm like, talking to David, and I'm like, dude, wouldn't it be great if we just did a tour? Because if I'm gonna be in New York, what if I did some like East Coast tour thing or something? Maybe we could figure out a way to fly there and then, you know, like take the equipment everywhere. But then I thought about it, I'm like, I just bought my brand new fucking truck. I have all this equipment. And then all the reality show people have been hitting me up and all this application. So I have so much going on. I'm like, we could get the most valuable footage of all time if we tour across America and do the full loop. I have the month, I make money while I'm sitting down. So why not?
And look at you.
So,
and it's funny because
Monday night.
Right now. That's my manifestation story now.
Well, for me, you know, I was like, when David told me he was going to see John Edwards, I was like, I have to go. I have to go with you. I have to shoot this. He's like, no, you know, they're going to fly me out. It's going to be this one thing. And then later on, it's like, hey, do you want to go? It's like, yes,
yes, I do. So, no, and I, you know, and he mentioned, you know, this tour, and I said, well, you know, Detroit's kind of on your way, so put it on your radar. And he's like, well, I'll do Chicago, it's close enough. And then his fan base, which includes me and these lovely women, you know, we were trying to figure out the Chicago dates, but it just wasn't working out, and we were all pretty bummed out about it. And then, in fact, but I saw in my head you being at Luminaries and doing. I saw the whole time that would transpire, and now it is. So that's pretty exciting too. Yeah.
Luminaries is a very strong pool.
Yeah.
It will take on.
It got my horoscope. It got me haircuts. Now it's got me doing a talk there. I'm like, wow. It's just like, it's like this cat right here.
She's still chilling.
Yep. They come from the same energy.
She's so funny. You know what we should do is I should take a picture of you with the cat and send it to Leah. Leah's my oldest daughter, and that's her cat.
I'll snap it to Leah.
Isn't she the one that's over by in San Diego or something? Yeah, that's funny.
Stand by the cat and snap it to Leah.
And snap it to Leah.
Talk about it. It's hilarious.
It's actually a video. Say hi, Leah.
Hi, Leah.
That's so cute.
Look at how cute that is.
That's funny. Oops.
Hi. Are you a good girl?
Personality of a cat.
Oh, man. Yeah, lot too much personality.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
One cat. Well, hey, the Leo King is a big cat, so. We know how to seduce in a unique way.
You're gonna have to tell me. I'm on the cusp of Virgo and a Leo.
What are you, August 22nd or
3rd? 23rd.
Oh, so you're Virgo.
Wait, my little niece is.
So look at you, Miss Kobe Bryant.
The time you're born?
The Virgo, you said?
He's October 23rd. Where's the restroom at?
Like, it's like the only way we can really watch the cosmos talk. So the cosmos are about to talk in 2 weeks with this full moon lunar eclipse happening in 2 weeks from now, because we have the new moon tonight. That's why you can't see the moon anywhere unless you wake up at 4. All those 4:30 a.m. people on the freeway in the morning. It'll be cresting. Like, oh, God. Those people can see it. I won't be covering it. And so when eclipses happen, let's just think about this. What is an eclipse? Well, it's when things are just too perfect. The sun and the moon literally come in such a perfect placement that when it's full, the earth comes in between the position of the sun and the moon and shadows the moon. So that's a rare aspect. Wow, it's like, almost like, it's like, oh, I always call it, oh, moments. It's like, oh my gosh, everything's perfect. Then there's the solar eclipse, which is literally when the moon perfectly comes in view and goes, oh my God, I'm going right in front of the sun. Who here has actually witnessed a solar eclipse where the sun disappears? Yeah, it's like the most magical moment of all time. And it feels like you're on a drug or something. You're like, oh my God, it's like so powerful. But in astrology, what's happening in the next month is really listen to how the universe is going to talk to you. If you do the astrologer, if you watch my horoscopes, we've been talking about the buildup to this event that's coming here. That life, especially with this equinox that we're talking with today, we also in astrology just had the planet Pluto move in a position. So this means like the world is all setting us up for this next month. It's gonna be very powerful, definitely life-changing. And so when eclipses happen, and if you forget to follow astrology or whatever, or horoscopes or anything, but just remember when the eclipses show up or when you look on your calendar, because there's always those full moon things, like, pay attention to that. The universe is definitely always at its peak moments at those spots, and they're usually the most powerful shift points in our life.
So I'm out here in Detroit, Michigan right now. This is my first time in Detroit. I'm here to see my great friend Natalia. She's an awesome business called visionboards.co. It's all about bringing spirituality to this new age world with applications and doing your dreams on vision boards. But we took a detour, and we got a big show we're doing tonight here in Detroit. And I'm doing a quick little radio, like TV interview before we even go do the show tonight in good old downtown Detroit. Never been here, but I love the city already. It's got a great vibe. The weather's great. Can't wait to see what's going to go on inside. I like Detroit. I think it's got an old vibe. You can tell there's a lot of history here. It's definitely not a new kind of energy, but I can tell that they're bringing it to new energy, which is nice to see. I just like the feeling. I think it's a good feeling. I feel very comfortable in the city. I would not be here if it wasn't for Michigan, because my grandparents on my dad's side, so my dad's parents, met at Michigan University. They're Wolverines, and they met, had my dad and his sisters, and I wouldn't be alive if it wasn't for Michigan. So I got something from Michigan deep down in my heart for my fam. I guess we're gonna try this entrance, because there's no other logical way to get in this motherfucker. It's like impossible.
There's a little bit of a, yeah. Because there wasn't enough gas money to get home. It'd be like $20, I'm like, fuck.
Right. Yeah, I had to, drop my price too, like, to get the whole bachelor party to do it. I'd be like,
no,
all right,
way.
All
flat
rate.
Yeah, flat
rate.
What do you practice, Western or Vedic?
No, I just mix it up with Chinese and Western.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah,
it's more of what I mix too. I'm more
like,
Western too.
He actually associates stuff with your chakras too.
Ooh.
Yeah, so.
What's your birthday?
August 10th, 1987.
Oh, you're another Leo, brother.
Yeah.
Love it.
And I had no idea about this, by the way, that he had this background.
I just got interested in it, and then I saw an opportunity to talk to some ladies.
What are the chances that I do a podcast with you and he's here? I mean, come on, that's
I'm developing the biggest astrology app of all time with all my content, because I'm a YouTube personality and TV personality, but due to the content that I push out every day, I pay a subscription-based astrology horoscope service, which I have now, which I can talk about now. Basically, people pay $7.99 a month, and I feed them video horoscopes now.
So that's, I think, what we should talk about, because our audience is typically, like, people in this community, like startups, people that are trying to find a way to, you know, branch out
right.
to, like, companies and stuff. So I think Natalie's going to be the guest host, so she's
cool.
Going to...
So one of our, I think, secrets to success with Vision Boards Echo, my tech company, was just kind of piggybacking off what you said, making sure we really leverage the wins we've had along the way. And I've kind of seen similarities. You've been on TV before, and you make sure you prominently say, as seen on TV. And you are wearing on your sleeve, because there's a sense of validation. And same thing, when we won accolades, we are proudly putting that out there. So I think that that's another part of it too, is like you said, you're almost like setting up this persona, if it's with your brand or your personality, and you're making sure to highlight these really cool features and experiences that you've had along the way to make sure that the audience senses some validation. So how have you chosen to do that? Maybe just give some examples of how you do that.
I think that you're on the money with this subject. Nobody really talks about it. If you look at big brands, whether it's, you know, the Tigers right here in Detroit, right? It's like, if you win the World Series, you put the banner up and you let people know that you won the World Series, or you let people know that you are the best at what you do. And that's important, because when you're proud of your achievements and you represent them, the brand does that much better. I think there's a need to show that, whether you're on TV and you put it on the website as, look at, you know, here's a video if you want to find out more about my brand. You know, I think it's important to have in your about section, or have aspects on your website or any of your apps or anything that you do, a section that is an understanding of the history or how you got there. I think
trust me, 10 years ago to even see this, you know, is
weird.
It's remarkable to see, you know. They left that statue of Marcia.
Uh-huh.
Related to one of the wars.
Well, if you live down here, you can either hear or I can't breathe. I can't breathe. I made it to the top of the world. So I am just getting into Denver right now, and it's beautiful. It's 91 degrees in Denver. I thought it was gonna be freezing cold and snow, but no, we're hanging out. Just about to go to the hotel room. I gotta do some things for the presentation. One thing about my presentations when I do these events is I don't plan anything. I fully channel it all. There's a semi-plan, of course, of I'm gonna be in astrology and there's certain aspects that I wanna talk about, but as far as exactly every detail of what I'm gonna say, I don't plan that stuff until I get to the town, I feel the energy, I channel the astrology that day, and then I go for it. So there's a really strong aspect that hits me when I come into a town, because I have to, you know, get everything ready physically, spiritually for the show. And so I'm excited, you know. Never been to Denver before. This is my first time. And actually, it's a pretty big city. I didn't know what I'd be coming into, but it looks like I'm coming into something really good here. And yes, I am on my cell phone. I'm going here.
I did this presentation called Sex or Tits in Astrology, Lightning in a Bottle. I don't know if you guys have watched my YouTube channel, but I went to, have you seen it?
I watched it, yeah.
And the whole point was understanding Saturn and Scorpio and how to either get laid through astrology or to understand sex astrologically, and I had redone this format and I forgot to figure out how to get laid through astrology.
It was good.
It
was really
good.
You liked it? Yeah, no, I did.
And all it was it wasn't that I was like, okay, I'm giving you a great way to get laid, son. It was a way of starting to understand the rawness of astrology, breaking down and bringing the truth of what it is. But, you know, so that's where I'm at today. But I definitely want to, you know, have questions, or if anybody wants to bring up something to talk about and be able to, you know, talk it out. So does anybody have any questions? Or
cusps.
You just keep going.
Talk about cusps again. Like,
cusps.
Yeah. That's what I
Well, think about it in technical terms. Has everybody here looked at an astrology chart before? No? So, an astrology chart, just like in kind of fun aspects of geometry, there's 360 degrees around the whole entire chart, right? So every degree has a number. So it's interesting that they do it from the number 0 to the number 29. They don't do 1 and 30. They do 0 and 29. So if you look at numerology, you guys heard of numerology? Numerology is actually based off planetary understandings of the numbers. So each number, and there's only 9 numbers, 0 is not a number, but you have to see that there's only 9 numbers. And so each number is affected in the positions of understanding where these planets are degrees. So when you're quote unquote a cusp, the position of the sun was at a position of 0. It was at the beginning of a new sign. Like, I always call it, I got my butt in Cancer or my, you know, my chest in Leo or whatever. Like, I'm in, you know, but I'm kind of not. And 0 is literally nothing. You add 0 times 0 to anything, guess what happens? 0. Nothing. It always comes back down to nothing. But the other aspect of 0 is that it adds power to everything.
Indeed.
So what being a cusper is a very weird thing. Because there's a part of you that knows how to just back out of the reality and kind of separate. And there's a part of you that when you come in really extremely. But you have an in and out quality of coming in and out, playing around. I call it the 13th sign. I call it the ghost. That you chose to come down here to kind of like mix and match around different energies and kind of be like a joker card.
I like that.
In, you know, thing. So my opinion, but you have to be a 0 usually to have that.
Okay, not even 2 degrees.
2 degrees you're in, but you're still cuspy because you can kind of, you know, think about this. Like,
I'm 2 degrees.
Like, think about, okay, like, think about being in a house and, or an apartment, other than an apartment, and, you know, next to me is the next person. I'm going to hear what's going on in that room. Now I'm in this room, but I can kind of hear.
Yeah.
Like, I can hear them cooking, you know.
Absolutely.
But the more I get in, I can't hear them. So when you're in a 0, you're literally like, you're on the wall, like, you know, you can almost kind of look at it and be like the Peeping Tom kind of. You know what I mean?
No, that makes sense.
Like, that's how I look at it. And then you have to always think of the numbers, though. That the numbers, and that's a whole other presentation, right? Numerology.
Check one, check two. Finally, food. Where do you want to sit? I don't know if I want to sit outside, do you? Tonight I did my show in Denver. It went really well. The people were amazing. They came from all over the place. Some people drove 5 hours. Some people drove 3 hours. I even heard that somebody flew to come, which was pretty mind-blowing for me. And it humbled me quite a lot. This event showed me even more about myself. And it really got me in touch with people who really care about me and really care about what I'm doing. And sometimes it was a little hard to accept. I've been noticing on the road when I'm touring and when I'm meeting all these people that sometimes it's hard to allow the praise, or sometimes it's hard to allow the appreciation. And I'm learning to open up more with that.
What did you think about some of the stories people had to say?
Some of the stories that I heard in Denver were very compelling. I felt like it was very relatable to even my own story. I think that doing this event and hearing other people's stories just made me realize that we're all in this together, and that's what I preach. But it's one thing to preach something, it's another to go out and actually physically do it and hang out with people and go through it. That's where the real work is. That's where the real understanding is. Yeah, thank you. Beautiful.
So are you starting to see evidence of your collective consciousness out there now?
Through these events, I'm starting to see that there's so many people really biting the message, really eating it, ingesting it, and really liking the way it feels. And it's magical to start in my home country and connect with everybody. I've already done up Pacific Northwest a couple years ago. Then I've now done Central America. Not like Central America, but you know, America in the middle. Done the East Coast, that's coming up here. I've pretty much been hitting the Southwest. I'll hit the South later in my tour. So for me, it's been quite a powerful experience actually connecting with the whole country.
What was the highlight of tonight?
The highlight of tonight was that everybody there helped me get through what I had to do. It was kind of difficult making it through this event because of how tired I am, and I'm traveling and I'm not feeling on my top game. It's hard to even talk. Even now it's hard to talk because I've talked so much. But the best part of tonight was that everybody was there for me.
Did you notice anything about the love in the room?
I definitely noticed that the love in the room was very healing. It was very grounding. And that the people in Denver had a very grounded but very new age sense. Everybody was very advanced in their consciousness and searching for really, really deep answers. And it was those very deep answers that really intrigued me. The questions that everybody asked were very, very intense and not very basic.
The group pictures seem to be a really unifying moment for everybody to
express themselves. Did you feel it when you were up there taking it?
The group picture was a very unifying moment. Everybody came together, they felt really good, and it really made me feel like we brought it in. At the end of the event, I asked to turn the lights off in the room, and I asked everybody to kind of come into a powwow and just talk about things. And there was a lot of intimate moments, there was a lot of powwowing, there was a lot of feeling like we all maybe knew each other at some time in our lives or something like that.
So, what are you feeling for Chicago?
Well, after finishing here in Denver, I'm feeling like Chicago is going to have a different element. It's at a different location. It's going to be on a weekend. And hopefully I'll have a little bit more rest so I can be a little bit more, not that I'm not sharp, but I could have a little bit more energy. I feel like I'm very drained after Denver, and not in a negative way, but a very positive way.
I get a little anxiety being here for some reason. And the air, without all the air, I just feel like, ugh. It's beautiful, don't get me wrong, but I feel a little off being here. I don't feel like very swaggy. But in my astrology chart too, I have Chiron coming through the middle of Colorado. Denver was really fun, but I am looking forward to moving on. I am from Hollywood, and it's a little bit different. I have nothing against Denver, but it's a little sleepy for me. I don't know why. I mean, it's really beautiful, but I think it's a little too tranquil for me. I'm a little crazy, so I need a little bit more spark.
Turn right onto Market Street.
I didn't feel that here, but I felt a lot of nice people and a lot of beautiful energy, and when I'm in my 40s or 50s or maybe even 60s, because I'm kind of crazy, maybe I would be able to settle down here. But for now, onward ho!
There's the monument. And that's the White House back there.
No, the White House.
Oh, the White House is over here? Sorry, this is my first time here.
There's the monument to the right.
This is a great place to record the scope. Nice park.
Well, boy, is this traffic guy gonna drop you on 17? Just walk a little bit before.
Yeah, no problem. You know, I feel like I'm exactly back on True Beauty on ABC. I'm in the exact same truck, in the exact same seat, although this time I'm not almost about to be eliminated. I'm totally in the opposite seat. I'm about to go do another show, and this one's like sold out, and we have more tickets sold than seats are allowed. And the venue guy, or girl, it's a Robin, I don't know who it is, kind of gave me a little issue saying, no, this is the max amount of people you're allowed in. But I got people coming from Connecticut, all over the East area, just wherever it is. I'm not really being at East Coast, but I have no idea how this is going to go. I got a feeling some people might be unhappy if they show up and they don't let them in. But that's what happens when the Leo King tours New York. So we'll see how that goes. Other than that, I'm just trying to remain calm. I've just had a little bit of tension. I got a lot of work on my plate. I gotta go film those TV shows on Monday and Tuesday here in New York, and the producers just told me I gotta do a lot of shots, so I'm gonna be shooting full time, and I gotta get up all my premium videos, and I gotta shoot a webinar all this weekend. So there's no such thing as vacation even when you tour. You work the whole entire time, and I'm noticing that here in New York, I'm working more than I've ever worked in my fucking life. You know, but I'm getting it going. But what I do like about this town is it's always moving. LA doesn't move as much. There's a little bit of a slowdown once the nighttime hits. Here, keeps going.
except in Hollywood, and you guys all know I live in Hollywood, so Hollywood doesn't sleep. But this is the only other place in America I can go to that feels like home.
But you can't be in. Like, it just sucks, you know? It's like, what are they doing in that room? You know? It's like, okay, yeah, yeah. That's a cusp. Well, being on the cusp of anything, whether it's a sign like we just brought up in astrology, or the sun, means the sun is literally like, okay, we're in the shitter, but we're actually going forward in the good night, so, you know? And we're literally not even 2 years in out of a 12,000 year cycle. So let's just do the, like, little math and play it out. Okay, good. Okay, 1 year went by. Go! 2 years, go! 3 years, go! People are having a lot of issues right now, especially doing this job. Trust me, I mean, I do this shit all day, you guys know all I do. Talk about astrology. So it's like it's harder to find people that understand it or understand. I'm sure you guys go through it or you wouldn't be sitting in this room together. Is that there's this awakening that's happened. And this awakening is the age of Aquarius, which I'm sure you guys have heard the song. Now I hate the song. I'm a house DJ. No way I'm going to play that track. It's too 60s for me. You know? It's like, da, 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 da. Like, get the outfit out and, you know, kind of do the whole thing. But the age of Aquarius is everything that's happening. Because, now this is where the Vedic astrologers come in handy. Is because they follow the procession of the equinox. Now what that is because we are an Earth that tilts all the time. Our view of the constellations change. Because trust me, when you're going around all the time, we're going to have a little bit of a wobble. It just happens. Have you ever done a top? When you throw a top, it starts to wobble. And there's an aspect of us wobbling. And so our view shifts of the zodiac. Hence, astrology is not based off the view. It's based off the constant. The age of Aquarius is actually about understanding how that view changes of where the sun will be every year on March 20th. Because as the pagan new year happens on March 20th, we take a snapshot of where the progression of the equinox is, which right now is at the end of Pisces. So that's why Aries in Vedic astrology are Pisces, because we look at that understanding. So what's happening is as we're coming to, actually it's the beginning of Pisces, because it goes backwards in views. The sun now on March 20th, pretty soon here, is about to make everybody who's an Aries an Aquarius. Because it's all going backwards. Right?
It's like the beard.
But that's how we can tell the age of Aquarius. Because in the ancients, they used to look at the age of the ram, which was 4,000 years ago when Aries was Aries, right? Then we had the last 2,000 years, which was the age of Pisces. Hence, you know, on the back of cars, you can see those little fish on the back. But it was also about, what does Pisces represent? Well, let's actually go back to Aries. What does Aries represent? Identity and self. It was a bunch of Cro-Magnon humans being like, I'm a man! That was all it was. Age of Empire, I'm a man! Going around and playing with things, and I'm gonna make big castles and eat. Right? Pisces was like, what the hell's going on here? You know, it's like, is it Jesus? I don't know. I don't know. Poor Pisces, I love him. But there's that element of always like, what? You know, because you have to be in the unknowing to become knowing in Pisces. You have to swim out of the water and in the water. And what does Pisces represent? Well, in typical astrology, it's ruled by the planet Jupiter and Neptune. And Neptune is a very weird planet. It looks like it's beautiful, but I don't know. You could go on there and there could be trolls on it. I don't know. You ever looked at Neptune? She's so beautiful. And like, but you know, you get down there, it could be like a crazy alien. I don't know. There's that deception, that fog, that weirdness about Neptune. So it's a really confusing place. Literally, humanity has been stoned for like 2,000 years. Which, if you think about it, we have been. When you ask somebody, oh, so, you know, why are we here? I don't know. Great. So what are we doing here? I still don't know. Okay, well, I think we're all screwed. Because Pisces tends to not give a crap. At the end of Age of Pisces, where we're at, we're all like, what religion are you? I could give a crap. Really. I mean, because Pisces is about surrendering, letting go, going with the flow. And learning to find awareness or true higher vibration. It also rules alcohol and drugs, right? We've been in a definite age of that for the last 2,000 years. Recreating those, so even when I'm doing my readings, sometimes I get it that way, but other times I'm able to, I don't know if you guys can tell, but I'll sometimes just look off way far away. Like, if I have this huge horizon line that comes when I'm looking off.
We know. We see it.
And when I do the horoscopes, it's a huge horizon line. And I have literally people walk up and they give me attitudes. And like we're happy or we're really pissed or we're like we haven't got this through or concerned. And so when I'm looking out there, sometimes I'll get all the guides, sometimes I get one guide, sometimes I get two. But when I'm doing a reading on somebody and looking at their chart, I look there and I'm able to see if they're satisfied with what I said yet. Sometimes I'll be like, I'll have to repeat something four times because I'm like, they're not, I don't care what you're telling me that you understand. They're telling me you don't understand it yet. So we need to keep going there until we get to a place that they're okay and they nod. And then once I get the nod, okay, let's move on to the next place.
That's so neat.
Because the guides have to say yes because they're the ones who aren't satisfied. Mm-hmm. They're hired to help you.
I totally feel that whenever I do like astrological readings, like I tell the people and I'm like, we went over this 1,000 times. We went over this 1,000 times. It's like you tell them the same piece of information over and over again. And then it's like a light bulb. Finally, they just decide it clicks.
I love that.
Isn't that cat hilarious?
Oh, she does it all the time. She'll actually sit on the floor.
She wants to
talk about this. And she's like, boom.
She's part of the circle.
Yeah. She actually usually sits on the floor against the wall and just sits just like that. And just
I want to Instagram that.
She just that is chills.
I know, I've been like, it's just cracking me up.
The kitty steals the show. Who wants to go grab the food?
She always
Anybody want to go grab the food?
Just chills.
I didn't drive.
Nobody wants to leave.
I know. We have to take a break.
Nothing, nobody delivered?
Who knows how to get there? That's the main question.
I'll go with you. Yeah. You want to go?
I know.
Also rules deception, that we've all been deceived for so long. Because in Pisces, it's deception. And there's an aspect of us being told about things that really are just invisible. It's like Wizard of Oz with the big man saying, oh, I'm the wizard. And then you go behind and you're like, yeah, right, dude. That the world we've lived in for the last 2,000 years has been just this big dude telling us crap. And especially, you know, religious aspects. It really highlights religion in Pisces. So as we're coming out of this and coming to Aquarius, I don't know one Aquarius that doesn't know, right? Aquarians are all about knowing everything because it's an intellectual sign. So this new age we talk about is about people truly knowing what's going on. Now, the only way to know what's going on nowadays for me is I got to get on this thing. And I gotta go, okay, what's my mom doing right now? Right? Because what does Aquarius rule? Interconnection between people and energy. So really the internet is the new world that we're entering in. The connection of all of ourselves is where we're moving. And it's also about integrating people with people. No longer can people not integrate. We've lived in a world where, you know, you can't even go like knock on your neighbor's door anymore without being a little weird. Like, ooh, is it the wrong time? I mean, they might have work tomorrow. Do you think they did that 2,000 years ago? Oh my God, I need to get something. But their hut doesn't have smoke coming out, so I'm not gonna go over there. We have to become people. We have to all integrate. So the age of Aquarius is about integration. It's about truly knowing mentally. I know what's going on. I have looked at the weird angle that we talked about, or the creep weirdo in the Last Supper. He's weird. So when you have that weird look at your life now, you will know. So the only way to know now as we enter this age of Aquarius is you have to become a rebel, which means you have to go against what the system has put in place. And the system that's been put in place is a calendar system, a time system that is not true to what we live in. It's that simple. That if you live your life by this guy, you're fucked. Because guess what it is? It's just a fake doormat to this world that doesn't have a constant. and humans created it in an age of what's going on. So if you want to trust that life and you follow your whole life by that calendar and your whole life by what you've been told, free will's beautiful, isn't it? When I started doing these presentations, I kind of like thought of the Matrix and how Morpheus offers Neo the red or the blue pill. Really, astrology is that pill. The horoscopes don't give you a real nice dose of it. I kind of like put a little in your drink and go, hi, hi, how are you? But when you start to get the real information or look, you really will take the red pill and say goodbye to the life that we've been taught to live, because it's what's keeping everybody stuck in a loop of slavery. And we're going to talk about that slavery a little bit. But before we do that, who here has heard about the divine feminine? So during this new switch of life, and of course, okay. Anyways, this beautiful aspect of life is where we are at with the feminine energy. Women are rising up, thank God. The guys are tired. We've built great cities. We've done all this great energy. But we're in a world that was so lopsided of the man, hence it's falling apart. We live in a world that needs the perfect balance. We live in a world that needs the woman to rise up, because we're at a time where we need the feminine to rule, because this is this moment of bringing this new light and this love to the planet and taking it out of the shitter, literally. And who do we usually call when we need to get out of the shitter? We usually call a woman up, right? Like, she cleans up the mess good. Men don't clean up right. They don't know how to put potpourri on things. You know, it's like, you know, there's an aspect of the woman coming in here to really rise and show the way. And this is a time in life that is so important, because we are going to watch women literally lead us into the new age. The men are having a hard time with this. No, give me 5 more minutes. We'll take care of it. It's not happening. But the other half of this is within all of ourselves. We all have to align our feminine and masculine. And that is a very weird place. You can see it in the world now, kind of really trying to work itself out with gay, lesbian rights, all these other aspects. It's become extreme. We're really fucked up. We don't know what we are, if we are, but in all of us is a feminine and a masculine energy, which when you do both together at the same and harmony rate, you become a master. And really the divine feminine is about learning in yourself to master your feminine side, because we've been in a world that's been taught so masculine. But more importantly, it's time for the masculine and the feminine to truly come together again, the right way. And that's what's so beautiful about this new life, is that if you can in yourself integrate that feminine right and integrate that masculine right, you're going to harmonize in your life so beautifully. But if you're very lopsided and look in your chart, trust me, I can look at somebody and be like, well, their Venus is all fucked up. And Venus rules feminine energy. I've helped a lot of people who have had issues with their feminine and masculine, whether they thought they were gay and then they weren't. I've watched it a million times. That, believe it or not, the subject is one that nobody's going to talk about, but I'm not afraid to. That a lot of people have issues with integrating both, correct. And it's that time. That's going to be the only way you can truly know your power, is to know how to handle both sides, to come together. What happens when you mix a man with a woman? Oh, you get a baby. There's an aspect of the power of the masculine and the feminine. When you put a battery in your phone, you got to plug the positive and the negative, right? If it's not aligned right, guess what? Boop. Doesn't work all the way. So there's some system malfunctions happening on our planet with this, because the battery can't load up with it off. Does that make sense? Like, and this is a subject that nobody really, I mean, we get all the divine feminine and the woman rising up and the goddess coming out and deet. That's beautiful. But there's an aspect of it really needing to work, because the feminine can't say no to the masculine anymore. Like, okay, I'm a goddess, bitch. I don't need you. I'm going to go and get a 12-story building here in New York and do my own life and just do it myself. And fuck you. I don't need you anymore. Well, guess what? That feminine aspect not coming with the masculine is an issue. And
the red, it's called, it's in my trunk.
All right, I'm going to need you to say Loma Fiber Putty. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, I like, it's called Mitch. It's not Paul Mitchell. It's
oh,
Mitch.
The Mitch line.
It's the Mitch line.
Okay.
I like it. Like,
is it like a pomade? Is it sticky?
It's, no, it's more firm and putty style.
It's like firm putty with a shine, so you don't like matte.
I know it's matte. It's matte.
Oh, it is a matte.
I like
matte. Okay. Alright, so I'm gonna take your one up to about here and then blend it up top.
Great. So how's your astrology been going?
My astrology has been going great. I'm super excited to infuse hair and beauty and fashion with astrology here in Rochester, Michigan. It's very exciting for me.
Are there a lot of people into astrology out here?
Yeah, I think something that I do is bringing the awareness to people, because not too many people have even heard of like a birth chart. So the moment you tell somebody there's a chart out there that is a blueprint of their soul.
Oh, what did I say? Oh, yeah. And that's right, you have Saturn opposed Chiron, you have Saturn square Jupiter, so, and Neptune's about to come towards it. So let's think about this. So you have Neptune going to square your Saturn at the same time. That's very interesting, isn't it?
I feel like
that's going to be a pretty holy moment. Your Saturn return is going to be much more intense than most people's.
Plus I'm a Taurus, all those eclipses.
Yes, I'm trying to think how this is going to work when this all happens. So let's just take the transit of Neptune here to square your Saturn. That the big decisions in your life that are coming in the next year and a half, 2 years, are going to be way bigger than any decision that comes. It's almost like you're going to have a new opportunity in your life that comes from this in the next 2 years, and you're going to have to really spiritually attune it and test it and make a big call for expansion. Making sure that it's not coming from any weird or subconscious energies, because you have Neptune in your 12th house transiting. Mm-hmm. So you have Neptune, and it's going to be in emotional houses. But all that really shows to me is that you're going to have two, usually because it's in two signs of duality, pretty much, especially Neptune being facing duality. You're going to have a big choice on your Saturn return to make, and it's going to be about how far you expand. And it's going to be kind of intense.
One of the biggest reasons why I'm always out here is because when you're in a city or even just in small towns, you can't see all the stars anymore where there's so much electricity. And we've lost that connection with really following what the stars have to say and seeing our path and seeing how we're part of this cosmic connection. We're part of this cosmic universe. So whenever I come out here, because I'm an astrologer, it's interesting to be able to see what I always see in an earthly or human style of map. But when you actually look up and connect with that energy, it really, you know, solidifies what you're doing. It really creates it in a real manner. And I feel like you have to have both sides. There's the human element of translating the astrology. There's the human element of doing all the charts. But there's the spiritual element, which actually doesn't even use any of that stuff. It's just that connection when you come out in the middle of nowhere and you start to put all those pieces together and you see what it's all about. Life is like music. When everything's rocking nice, the banjo's playing. No, let's not use banjo. I'm going to New Orleans on this trip now. But let's use rock music. You know, when the guitar is going, the bass is going, the drums are going, the lead singer's going, and then you get the background singer, and it's just like this moment of everything's clicking. Oh my God, it's the most amazing thing on the planet. That's the way the universe is. The way that all these planets are moving, the way that things are going, everything is always in perfect harmony for a reason, to play the notes of the song that the universe wants to play, to have us listen to and go towards, because it's meant to get you where you need to go. The issue is that people in this world now think that they are running the jukebox and that they can play jazz in the middle of rock
And sometimes that works, but there's only one or two bands that ever get it off good. Most of them suck, right? So the part of this life that trips me out about the most about astrology is destiny. Does it all happen, or do I have control of what's happening? I still am pondering this question. Some days I go, oh my God, it's destiny. Then other days I go, oh my God, I totally did take control of that, didn't I? And it did work out. I think it's both. I think that we all have a path that we're reaching towards, but we have that free will to go in any direction we want, to take there. And then we have multiple subways that we can take at all times. And there's multiple tracks to take. But I think the most important aspect is to take the subway train that goes along with the music that should be playing. So if there is a jazz station and the universe is playing jazz, I would use my free will to take that jazz. And that's what astrology is, the horoscope, you know? Like right now, it'd be stupid to go play the old way. It'd be stupid to go base your identification of life on the way that's been done for 250 years because you'll probably lose, like a lot of people will at the end, just based off the astrology. And you know what? You have no idea how many hate mails I get at people. You're telling my daughter that she's in school. We spent 50K and blah, blah, you know, I get it all. And I'm like, hey, I'm just putting out information on YouTube. You know? But think about it. If the astrology is changing that much and the electricity that's coming with Aquarius, and if we look at the astrology and this Pluto-Uranus thing, like, think about the future. Astrology is about knowing about your future and about knowing to make the right choice to get on the right path. Always pick the science that... Astrology is about knowing that this science works. The science of humans has not worked, unfortunately. I mean, at one point, we were putting shampoo on dogs to make sure it was good for humans and killing the dogs. Like, at one point, we thought it was okay to have dictatorships, you know? At one point, we thought it was okay to, like, let off an atom bomb into a couple cities. You have to see that, like, if you start paying attention to the life that humans have created, which is the calendar system, if you base your whole life off that damn calendar, like, I gotta be there on March 20th or else. But if I base my whole life off astrology. Everything. I plan every business thing. I plan this whole adventure. I plan my retreat. If I had a retreater here, Miss Deb right there. It was all pre-planned because I knew that the universe was opening up all the right doors, all the right gateways, and I'm listening to the music that's playing and basing my free will off that music. Because when you do that, you get harmony. The way God looks at it is God is like a little kid, I think. I think the universe is like a little kid who's like, oh my God, they're playing that horrible tune again, but I'm going to have to listen until I like it, huh? Oh, until they play a good one. I feel like that's what the universe does. It just is so beautiful and nice and goes, okay, they're just going to keep playing that tune again, you know? But when are they going to change and play that tune that's matching my rhythm? Because let's get together. And the reason why I say that is the age of Aquarius... Oop. The age of Aquarius is so intense because have you guys ever looked at an Aquarius sign? It's the little squiggly line and the other little squiggly line. They go with each other at the same rhythm. So Aquarius is about how do we innovate by connecting the self with the universe at the same wavelength. And to me, that's what astrology is that we all now have to go on the same rhythm with the universe. And if we don't, we're fooling ourselves. Because we're gonna mess it up, you know? And that's just proof. The reason why they say history repeats itself, it's true, but history doesn't have to repeat itself shitty. We don't have to have countries fall. We don't have to have the same kind of patterns repeat because we could have the same history that is the sun that rises every morning, the same that the sun sets every day, the same that those little pretty birds chirp every morning and make a nest and that never, do you see that we could have the same beautiful pattern constantly if we want to, but we're living in a world that has chosen and it's all from the individual that isn't doing that. In all the Palladian channels, and if you've heard me, I'm a Palladian channel, that's what I do, is it's about bridging your light into the world, and it's about frequency. So the same frequency that my cell phone is, we don't see the energy of the cell phone coming in our phone, but we're on it all day. Imagine if we saw what I was talking about. What if I was talking dirty to a girl? Everybody would see, oh, I'm taking off her pants or something, you know what I mean? But you don't, because it's invisible. It's frequencies, and I know I use harsh analogies, but it's fun.
is think about that there's all these frequencies around us all the time. There's all these bands of light. There's all this band of energy that's happening. Even that camera, for some reason, I don't know how it takes the image of me and puts it back on the camera. We don't see this information. So think about being in a three-dimensional world. Whenever you start hearing about fourth, fifth dimensions, you start bridging more information that you can't see. What's happening is that humans have been stuck in a world where we cannot see all the frequency of light. And we're in a world that purposely knows that you can't see all the frequency. So it subliminally has frequency controlled everybody into being a certain way without being able to see it. Being in a country that says you're free when you're really a slave or whatever. So I might sound like I'm an anarchy crazy person, but really I'm just trying to expose what the astrology and spirituality and the gift of this all says. Is to that you are the only one that can alter your frequency into listening to what the universe's frequency is and not the manipulated cell phone transmissions that are coming out every day to us all on television and the news and all these things. Because what's happening is we're all now basing our life off that and not off this.